Hi.
Yes, I do teach forgiveness.
My greatest teacher in that was my mother-in-law. I don't think anybody was in second place. And it's very interesting being a forgiveness teacher because nobody wants me. Because we really love being pissed off. And underneath that, we just love being right. And it's very interesting when I come into groups of people who their purpose in some degree is to do good in the world, which I know has something to do with it. You're here. I'm always struck by how that's much more difficult than you might think. Because the problem with doing good often is that you make the people who disagree with you as people who aren't doing good. And so you continue in goodwill, but often naivete, an adversarial position. And that often and usually doesn't lead to a peaceful outcome or even a resolution that many of us would consider good, because we contaminate it too much with our own lack of humility and our own exaggerated kind of love affair with our opinions. So what's very interesting is, how do you bring forgiveness into that, or how do you recognize that no matter what opinion you have and no matter how strongly you hold that opinion, a lot of people are going to disagree with you, and that they have every right to disagree with you, and they're, from their point of view, their opinion is as right and as valid as yours. So that's a much tougher thing than just banding together with other people and thinking you're right and justified and that all goodness resides with you and all the ways that most of us do our social good. That and what's interesting is most of us carry our egos with it, which has some value. The problem comes when we carry our egos and our adrenaline. When you carry just your ego, you can still be talked to. When you carry your ego and adrenaline, you can no longer hear. And when you can no longer hear, I believe you become so much less valuable to the world as a whole, because, you know, we need to, like, not just be right, but listen. And not just have an opinion, but recognize that there's a whole host of opinions. You know, I think back upon my life, and, you know, I'm of the age where we marched against the war in Vietnam, and I'm 100% convinced that war was wrong. And yet every now and then I meet really bright people who are absolutely convinced that I'm wrong. Just really bright people who know as much as I do. And it's very interesting, they just reached very different conclusions. So do I argue with that person? Do I embrace their knowledge? What do I do? Now, I remember once sitting on a plane, I was flying back from Phoenix, and it was Southwest Air, and so the stewardess people are allowed to be funny, which was wonderful. So the woman gets on the little speaker thing and says, "Hi, you know, welcome to Southwest Air. We're here for your safety," which is great. "And if you want anything else, like, don't ask." And I just broke out in laughter, because it was so nice not to have her just read that little scripted thing where everybody's asleep. And the guy next to me laughed too, and so we started to chat. And I'm a teacher of forgiveness, so we started to chat, and then I asked him what he did, and he was an Air Force pilot. And we ended up with an interesting conversation about the Iraq War, which he was 100% in favor of. And I was whatever percent I could be, thinking that we were the invading force. The problem was he knew 100 times more than I did. And it was very interesting to watch first my ego kind of dissipate a little bit, because nobody had ever tested my opinions that deeply, you know, because I live here and everybody's got the same opinion. So, no, it's true. It's really, it's so much easier to be righteous when everybody agrees with you. And it's one of the fascinating things that I've had teaching forgiveness in the Bay Area is politically it's so homogeneous that there isn't that much intelligent discussion around it. I used to kid that, you know, this Stanford zip code, and 9405, but that it's like 90% Democratic, the zip code, something like San Francisco zip codes, and that it would be very interesting to consider if, like, the Republicans ran, let's say, Mahatma Gandhi, and the Democrats ran Attila the Hun, it would probably be a 50-50 contest, you know, because we're so biased in our points of view. So I'm sitting there on the plane talking to this guy, and he just flat out knows more than me. Any little opinion that I put out about, you know, we did this and we did that and George Bush is terrible and all the stuff that I believed and everybody around me believed, he could knock away Letico's feathers. And I got an unbelievable education by that. That very, very, very bright people who know a lot often know more than me, and their certainty is better than my certainty. Because they know flat out more. This guy was a squadron leader. He had done research. I had just had a few opinions. My intention was, I believe, equally as good as his. That we both wanted some goodness for that region. Our ways of manifesting it were entirely different. And I had to walk away with a little bit of an enhanced sense of humility, which was really hard, especially if you teach here. Like, it's like, we want humility. I had to forgive him for being smarter than me. And I had to forgive myself for having such unsubstantiated opinions. And it was very, very, very interesting practice to have an understanding that in many situations being right is not enough. That you have to be aware of alternative points of view, and at some level you have to welcome them. Because we simply don't know that much. And my guess is that a little enhanced humility and the capacity to have an opinion, stick your ego behind it in a modest way, but absolutely not put your adrenaline in there so that you can still listen, is probably a wonderful thing for social cohesion and good. Now, I'll tell you a very interesting, one interesting story and one little factoid that, we professors, that's what we do, we have little factoids. They gave Democrat and Republican people like little fact sheets about their points of view. And they asked the Democrats, like, do you like this fact sheet? So if the fact sheet was written by a Democrat with huge, like, positives about Democratic ideals and long lists of, you know, this person was active in Democratic politics and, you know, feeds their kid Democratic cereal and all this stuff, then they preferred the Democratic fact sheet that was flat out wrong than the Republican fact sheet that was accurate but was written by somebody who fed their kid Republican cereal. Now, that's a big challenge to us. There's lots of data about how we'd rather get information that supports our preconceived ideas rather than teaches us and forces us to grow and learn. So look what happens when you have a whole world with that kind of approach. Rather pushing their opinions, making other people wrong, and absolutely limiting the amount of information they get that may challenge their thinking. So I'd be very careful with that inside of myself and you. One other factoid, and then I'm going to finish with my story. The other factoid is the left hemisphere of your brain, the part that's the language center. Its purpose, mostly, is to take incomplete bits of information and turn them into stories of threat. That's mostly its purpose. So that you stay safe. Not necessarily smart, not necessarily wise, not necessarily, you know, us, but that you as an individual organism are protected. So it does that by filling in many, many gaps of information. So that's what I was doing when I was on that plane talking about Iraq. I had like six little facts, and I filled them in with all sorts of other stuff to protect my own identity and to follow out with this safety of mine. Doesn't always work. We then repeat our stories to ourselves over and over and over again. So what I came up here to talk about for a few minutes, and then I was also asked to lead a meditation, was on this capacity. Can you have an opinion? Can you hold that opinion? I mean, without flooding your body with adrenaline so that other people can have their opinion too. It's like a really good thing. Can you do that at home? Can you do that when you discuss political options? Can you do that when you're trying to change other people? How can you do that? It's a very interesting thing because that's at the heart of forgiveness. You know what I teach? That can you hold your opinion about things being right, wrong, indifferent, good, bad, whatever, without needing your body flooded with adrenaline? Without having to use adrenaline to make you feel stronger than you actually are? That left hemisphere is weaving stories all over the place of threat and danger, and here's all the enemies and all the ways that you have to protect yourself. Well, that part of us needs to be being taken care of or handled in a different way. So I do this as a forgiveness teacher, but I'm weaving in an idea that I'm gonna also show you a couple of practices around this, of how we teach forgiveness, not necessarily because your brother-in-law, you know, lied to you, but because maybe you were in an argument with somebody about how to do something. Or maybe your group opposes another group, or maybe your way of doing this appears to meet, you know, resistance, which is called planet Earth. How do you do that without making an enemy of the people who are of different points of view? That's part of forgiveness. Forgiveness is like, yes, an inner quality of some kind of calmness. But it's also a decision not to use hate speech at all. And I think that's something we all have control over, not for us to use hate speech if we ever want to make the world a better place. And so, again, the left hemisphere of your brain is going to trigger adrenaline that's going to make you want to use hate speech when somebody has either opposed you or doesn't agree with you or frustrates you. But I have found that if we can calm down the adrenaline in us, like I asked you to do, and I'm going to ask you to do one more time, we can use our mouths to voice our opinion without hate words. We can do that. So I'm going to ask you to just take one more moment to quiet down, and then I'm going to ask you to share just a very simple thing with somebody else. It's just a practice. So I'd like everybody to just close their eyes for maybe 1 minute. This is just one more moment of meditation, just 1 minute. And I'd like you to inhale and exhale once or twice. And then after that inhalation, just on the next inhalation, we're going to count a couple of our blessings. As you inhale, I just want you to count the blessing of being alive and able to breathe. Like as you inhale, just say thank you for that. And then in another inhale, I would like you to just say thank you for your capacity to think, and for your ability to generate ideas and to hold opinions. And what a gift that is, that your mind works, that you're smart, and that you can be committed to ideas and opinions. What a wonderful thing. And say thank you for that.
And then with one more inhalation, just say thank you again for the opportunity to both express your opinions and to listen. Because that's what is the foundation of our goodness, is people, relationships, is sharing of ideas, is creating us where possible. Thank you for being able to speak and to be able to listen. They're both critical. It's not just one. And then I'd like you to take a breath, allow your eyes to open, and then I'm going to ask you to share something very simple with somebody near you, which is, I'd like you to think of one event in your life where your mouth said things that were a little harsher than you would have liked. And you felt right and justified. And you may have been right and justified. And please don't pick a catastrophe in your life. You get 2 minutes for this. Just pick anything. Like, you know, I called up, you know, I don't know, Blue Cross, and I yelled at the lady because she had me wait 4 hours. It's perfectly justified, but you know, you might have wanted to dial back the contempt. I want you to think of something very simple where your mouth was harsher than was necessary, because you felt justified. And just have a brief discussion of, if you could do it again, how would you have done it? Okay, everybody see what I'm asking you to do? Just a simple conversation with somebody near you. I'm gonna give you like 4 minutes because my time's just about done. Please have a conversation of what you did and then how you might have rewound it if you could. Thank you.
And I'm not going to ask you to meditate again, but I want to bring to your attention the value of a bit being centered and undistracted. That you stay quieter inside. And so when you have an opinion to offer, which we all do all the time, you want to make sure that as little of it as possible is simply your tension, which often is much of our opinions. Anyway, I thank you all. I hope you learned something.